not like it was before. It's grown.
It's Judgment Day. Which is why we need as much help as we can get.
Almost here.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to Real Time for the Real Everyday Movie Fan. I'm Josh Williams.
And I'm Ryan Murphy.
And today we're giving you our Real Time TV recap of Stranger Things Season 2. Who's all
Stranger Things, of course, stars Millie Bobby Brown, Gaten Matarazzo, Finn Wolfhard, Caleb McLaughlin, Winona Ryder, Noah Schnapp, David Harbour, Natalia Dyer, Charlie Heaton, Joe Keeney, Matthew Modine shows up for a little bit, Dacre Montgomery, Sadie Sink, Cara Buono, some great, Sean Astin, of course.
Sean Astin, the great.
So,
and created by the Duffer Brothers and
Matt and Ross Duffer.
And also Sam Levy.
Sean Levy, major executive producer on the show.
Yes, and they each direct quite a few episodes of this. So let's kind of get started. We're actually going to give scores and kind of go what we each liked and didn't like. Let's start with you. What are your overall thoughts, and what was your score? Just as a whole season, as a whole.
As a whole, it's kind of hard because I'm gonna say maybe I'm just gonna go for it. 9 out of 10.
Wow.
Because it's funny because I really was kind of a little bit hard on the first half of the season. It was slow, and whatever was happening was kind of didn't seem all that like important at first, or it didn't seem all that very perilous at first. It just seemed sort of like, okay, something's gonna happen. It has to do with this stuff, it didn't grab you. And the first couple episodes were actually pretty slow, which I actually liked. I liked the fact they were building the characters, but the actual threat, like, even when they were trying to get serious, it was like, I'm not really taking this seriously. But then, even, like, the other thing is that this show is made up of all these groups of characters, and even if you've seen the first season, this kind of happens just like the first season, where it's like you have all these groups, not all of them necessarily know what's going on with everyone else, and they're all handling different situations that have to do with the same thing.
They're handling the repercussions of the previous season to now.
And they're handling different things that have to do with the same thing. And what I thought was, especially in the first half, was that they were just trying to give some of the characters something to do. Like, they had the main story that only had to do with a few characters, and they were just trying to give the other ones something to do, and it was just sort of killing time. And so when they kept going back to the main story, it didn't have as much, it wasn't drawing me in as much because they kept cutting back and forth. But once it got going, like the last three episodes were awesome, and the finale of this season,
the snowball was just so great.
Okay, we have to maybe cut that out now because we don't want to.
This is a TV recap. We can talk.
Can we spoilers?
Yes, this is full on spoilers.
So I would have talked differently then, but he's in charge.
This is a TV recap. You're going into this knowing that you have seen this show.
So honestly, the way everything came together, what was remarkable to me. The entire final episode was they still had this war being fought on three fronts, and the way they cut back between the three, and the way that the three were constructed around each other, and the way that things happen, and that, you know, we have to get from point A to point B as writers. How do we make that happen? Let's do this. And the way they wove it all together, this intricate weave, I just thought, this is masterful. And but for me, the snowball, the final scene of this season, should be taught in screenwriting classes. As far as characters, having groups of characters, Joss Whedon would be proud. as far as just having a group of characters who have each their own shtick, their own story, and having something that ties them all together, and every character, it gets their due in that last scene. It's just like perfect. It's just like,
I loved it with Dustin. Yeah. Like, at first I was like, I was so heartbroken.
The Dustin thing was
tragic because, like, he's thinking, you know, because by that time he's buddies with Steve.
Right.
So he's like, I can be Steve. And then he has that realization that he's not Steve.
Right.
He's just like, it's so heartbreaking. But then, out of nowhere,
Nancy.
Nancy, sorry, yeah. I lost her name. She just comes up, and I thought that was a very nice gesture of her just to be like, okay, you know, he's such a good kid. I'm going to come dance him and show.
Right.
And I like the fact that you saw the looks on all the girls' faces, like, oh, yeah, he's dancing
it's
with
just,
her.
Yeah, and just the way, and then even like, and they chose the quintessential 80s love song time after time.
And then I'll be watching you. I love I'll be watching you.
No, but
you.
To
I
me,
love that.
What was great was that they even went outside the building, and of course, Winona Ryder was there. And Hopper was there, and so like we're including them in this. We can still hear the song, and because of the plot, you know, the plot device is that she can't leave Will alone. She has a hard time. That's why she's here, but she's there.
Yep.
You know, like that's the writing reason why she's there. But the point is, she is there, so we're still hearing the song. And it just like that's what I'm talking about. This weave of like bringing things together and having this thing where every character sort of has their moment in that, and it just like poof, that is writing. And like I just loved it. I loved it. Like I thought that's terrific. So
for me, I firmly love this show. I've loved this is to me a perfect follow up to a great first season. It's probably just as good as the first. I'm going as well. Probably I'll go 9.3. I'm a little higher than you. But I'm right there with you. This was such a fantastic interwoven story. Mm-hmm. Well, like you said, like their characters were kind of doing their own different things. I liked it because it showed that they're still dealing with the Reaper. Even though it was a year later, they're still dealing with the repercussions of what happened. Like with Nancy, with Barb, you know, how she's still like feeling responsible kind of in a way and for Barb's death. But also at the same time being mad because the Department of Energy is covering this up.
Right.
Now, yeah, there's brand new people there, and it's not the same evil people as first season, but they're still covering it up.
Right.
You know, they could have came up with some excuse, you know what I mean? But they chose not to, which that's why she kind of goes on her quest, on her conquest to, you know.
And that was nice.
I liked it.
That was nice. It was more the dog, the demo dog, and all everything that was going on with the kids just seems so
I love, okay, we'll get to that here in a second. But besides that, I actually liked the slow pace because the payoff.
Yeah.
I like the slow pace, like the slow burn of the show, because that, like he said, that last three seasons, the payoff was so great.
Yeah.
Like the action sequences with towards the end there with Sean Astin, although sorry not action, but the horror scenes with Sean Astin was just some of the best scenes I've seen in Netflix television, or even just in horror, you know, this year. It was really great, and I loved still besides the core characters, besides Dustin, Mike, Lucas, and Will. I loved the evolution of a lot of these different characters. And I also loved the introduction to different types of friendships along with it, which I'll have us talk about here later on. But besides that, yes, I loved the snowball. I loved how the end kind of, how pretty much the Department of Energy shut down because Barb's story came out, which makes me intrigued to see how things are going to move forward.
Yeah.
But besides that, what's going to actually, one of the things I liked, which will kind of segue into what some of the things I want to talk about during this recap, was the nostalgia within the show. You got to agree, like, the music choices were so great.
The finale, of course, yeah.
Yeah. I was going to ask, what is probably one of your most favorite like songs within, besides the two ending ones?
The only one, two that I remember. I don't even know what the hell you're talking about.
But a lot of just the different, like the Ghostbusters theme when they're in there, like when they're in their Ghostbusters uniforms, that was
and
really
it was
great.
84, of course. So like next season will probably be about Back to the Future, probably some stuff about.
And
that.
And that's some of the nostalgia, like little Easter eggs that are in there. I love that. In what was it, the first episode, where they're driving downtown, all of a sudden you see the Terminator,
right?
Just like at the movie theater, like it came out at that year.
But,
it came out.
But like I didn't even realize. Maybe you saw this on Facebook where someone pointed this out, and I didn't realize. And I'm surprised you didn't say anything about it. You weren't laughing your ass off when this happened. Was when Sean Astin looks at the treasure map and he goes, "What's the X? Pirate treasure?"
Yeah,
I didn't get that. Like, how did you not get that, Mr.
Goonies? I'm such a Goonies guy, and I was still like.
I was like that.
Maybe it's because Bob, like his creation of Bob, this character was kind of his own. It was kind of this goofy dude who just like is clueless as all hell.
Yeah.
And yeah, when he says, "Yo, what's at the X? Pirate treasure?" I should have got it. I should have got it when I first saw it. But after I saw that too, after I saw it, I'm like, "Oh my god, that's so." But that's great writing. That's great, like giving homage to the 80s.
I love. I don't know if this counts as an Easter egg, but I love when Lucas tries to tell the whole story of season one to Max. She goes, I liked it. She thinks it's a story. She goes, yeah. I liked it. I just thought it was a little derivative in parts. Yeah. I was like, that's brilliant.
That's
like,
so brilliant.
That's terrific.
But one of the other things I loved, because it brought me back even to my 90s childhood, was the arcade scenes were so great, because I saw a lot of the games I used to play when I was a kid. Even in, there's an arcade bar here mm-hmm. that we can play a lot of those games. A lot of those little spots I really liked, because then... And just like even small stuff, like there's a Jaws poster in someone's wall. Just a lot of these things that really helped encapsulate, even like intensified more. They really added up the nostalgia in the second season. Mm-hmm. And at first I thought it wasn't going to work, because I read about that they're going to add like so much more nostalgia. But it worked. Like it made me even geek out even more throughout the season. I think you can agree. One of the other things I like to talk about, let's talk about some of the new characters.
New characters.
So let's we can bring up Bob.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll let you pick. I'll pick a few as well. Bob, Max, Billy, which Max is one of the new groups of the group. Billy, her older brother, played by Dacre Montgomery. Murray, who is the guy who the investigative journalist. We've got Dr. Owens, the new guy, the head of the Department of Energy, and Cal, number eight. Let's talk about her as well. And then lastly, I think we can talk about Dart and the Mind Flayer. Dart was kind of, I actually kind of like Dart. I wanted to maybe, if you wanted to bring him up.
Yeah.
I thought it was kind of cute because it gave Dustin something to care about.
I thought, yeah, but it didn't have a lot to do with everything that was going on.
No,
it had
not
some
necessarily.
Nice moments with him, but I ultimately didn't think it was like narratively worth it.
But the other thing we talk about is the Mind Flayer for sure.
Well, yeah, but Max, I think, was, because when the season started, I was like, I don't know that this is the right way to go. I don't know if this is, you need like another kid. Like you need to introduce the other girl.
I can see, yeah,
and,
I can see that.
Yeah, like when the first half of the season, I was like, is this really like, did you need to do this? Is this really where you want to go? And of course, the whole story with the kids wasn't really amounting to much in that. But again, by the time the show was over, I fell in love with her. And she's part of that end scene where it's just like,
I felt so sympathetic for her too, because even with Mike was kind of treating her like, because I get it, because maybe Mike thought she was trying to take Eleven's spot mm-hmm. or Jane, whichever you want to call her now. So I can see that maybe, but I felt like he was kind of shitting on her pretty harshly. And whereas Lucas and Dustin were kind of really, you know, geeking out about her because she's such
like
a good arcade.
I like that as a.
But even then, like how she get treated by her brother, just how she kept getting shit on throughout this whole show. And even, oh my God, I thought it was a bad character moment for Eleven to do that moment where, mm-hmm. you know, Max goes, hey, you know, it's nice to meet you. I heard so much about you. And she just like walks right past her. I'm like, damn, that's kind of, I don't know if I like that, but. I really liked...
She's an 11-year-old girl, and she's creeping on her man. Like, step off, bitch.
Even though he was a stereotypical bad antagonist, I kind of liked Billy.
He was... Dr. Montgomery did a really
good
job.
He did a great job. And it's probably his best moment was when he opens up the door to Mike's mom, and he's just kind of, like, flirting with Mike's mom, like, oh, this is going to happen next season. I have a feeling it's going to be a fair in the coming seasons.
Anything goes,
but... Yeah. What are some of the other characters you like?
That pretty much does it. Bob, I think we said what needs to be said about Bob. The Mind Flayer, is an unseen villain or not? I mean, it's not like he's a villain with character development or anything like that. But he's a monstrous villain. He's gonna obviously be the main villain of the series. I think that's what he was, the person that was leading up to from season one till now. So in future seasons, like basically this show is gonna be about him trying to break into our world.
Yeah, and I kind of like that because I remember we and you talked about like, well, how the hell is he going to? Because Eleven basically shut the door in his face.
If we want to talk about the finale, like how the story all comes together, it's pretty much closed. Like at the end of season one, one of the problems I had season one was that it ended on this, it ended with a lot of cliffhangers, a lot of unresolved things. This tied everything together nicely, and you know they feel like they have to have a cliffhanger, so they insert that little thing of him like, ah, and it's like, that's not a cliffhanger, that's not even a tease, like he has no way of getting, like if anything that's him being like, damn it, you know, like, so
well now
we know
but
that he will come
we know
back.
We don't know how it's gonna happen, but you know, like he's, but I like the fact that very last scene where you see he's still watching, he's still it reminds you that he's still there. The sentient being with the hive mind mentality is still there. He's probably a very intelligent creature. And I love the fact that I like the idea that he's not only looking, because I think he still has a connection to Will in some fashion, but I also think that he's not only looking at Will, but I think his eyes are more set on Eleven now, because up until that point, you realize up until she shut the door in his face, he never met her. He never knew she really existed necessarily. Yeah. And now that she has his attention, I think now for
that's,
sure.
And you know, that's, she's obviously the most, maybe not the, I don't know if I'd classify her as the lead, but she's sort of the flagship character.
Definitely.
Of the show. She's sort of the Wolverine of the X-Men. You know, she's sort of the one that people are there to watch. Certainly you. We were talking about, like, are we like, with the kids, some of the romances between the 11-year-olds. I mean, are we, like, rooting for, like, this romance between, like, and you're, like, this guy, he's, like, you're, like, an 11 Mike Shipper. Like, I'm just, like, calm down, dude. They're 12.
Like, you know? But, like, when Mike and 11 finally kissed, I'm, like, good on you.
I more like the moment when she walks through the door and they find each other and they hug.
That was really great.
You know, the as far as the romance goes, I mean, naturally that's going to happen. I'm not, like, invested too much in it. I'd rather see maybe when they're older, but like that moment just of that, you know, when they come together, that was a terrific moment as well. Like towards the end, like I said, those last three episodes and the fact that they could take their time, they have a huge cliffhanger with episode 7.
Yep.
And then like they take the time, like, oh, let's go do this thing with 11.
That's totally, yeah, side story.
It was like,
11.
It was,
I
like,
really
let's
did.
Tell a total side story right at the tensest moment of the show, just to tease you that much more.
Right.
And then, like, it doesn't really have anything to do with the story, but it has to do with Eleven's character, and it has to do with teasing future stories. So we just insert it in a way that you can do in a TV show that you couldn't have done in, like, a movie. So it was great, I thought.
I like the idea of introducing 8, or Kali, or however you say her name is.
Yeah.
Her character name.
Yeah.
But I liked introducing to her, because now it opens up the idea, because there is... there's like 1 through 7, and now 9 through 10 before you get
maybe,
to
maybe past.
Maybe 11. There's more, and I like the idea
maybe
they're building something to where like maybe all these you know, numbers of maybe have different abilities, and they all maybe might come together to fight off like the finale of with the mind flare, because the Duffer Brothers have said they have a finite, they have an idea, they're only going to do 4 or 5 seasons, and that's it, because they have an overall story arc that they want to tell, and that's it. They're not going to keep going, you know, just to find things. They have a set idea of how they want their series to end, and I like that, because maybe they're building towards something that could be really great.
Yeah, and we can talk about what's in the future, but as far as talking about the characters go, before we get off of that, we talk about some of the new characters. Let's talk about some of the present characters.
Yes,
both thinking of the same one.
But go ahead.
I was thinking Steve.
Steve, yes.
We love Steve.
Well, I was talking about the evolution of some characters and some characters' relationships. Let's talk about Steve, not just Steve, but talk about Steve and Dustin.
Steve,
I really loved
that
friendship between them, kind of like a big brother, little brother thing.
When I was watching season one, you know, Steve, I thought for sure was just going to be a one-off character. And he was never the super bad boyfriend. That was the other thing. They kept him, like, he was just sort of, like, unideal. He wasn't a bad guy. He was just, you knew he was unideal, and that he wasn't, and then he was going to go away after a while. And then he didn't. And then I thought he might die in the finale when he came and joined them or whatever. I thought it was going to be like, what the hell is going on here? You know, I thought that was going to be Steve's thing.
Yeah.
And then it didn't happen. And then he like, you know, he, you know, becomes
he
a part of the game.
He became so much more.
And so with this season, they, in order to have something to do with him, kind of, they have him form this bond with, of all people, Dustin. And he gets a really close relationship with the kids. And that's like,
sorry, his microphone was about to ready to fall. But anyways, I didn't mean to get him off his tangent. But
he gets a really good relationship with the kids. He's like, yeah, I'm a good babysitter. Like, he's sort of the bridge almost between the teenagers and the kids. And then he's not with Nancy anymore. And I think that'll be the way he's still involved with everybody, is that he, like, at the end, he's giving Dustin a ride. Just turned out to be a great character.
I love that he's playing like a big brother role to Dustin.
Yeah.
But I feel like he's probably now one of my, besides 11 and Mike... Well, I'm not sitting on the mic now. Mike's kind of emo-ish in this show, but that's besides the point. But I think Steve's become one of my most favorite characters.
Yeah, absolutely.
To me, he's had the most growth.
Yeah.
And, like, the most maturity throughout just these two seasons alone. And I love that last scene before he drops off Dustin, just, like, giving him these pointers and that railroad scene when, like, they're just sitting there talking. I love that dialogue with them.
Yeah.
It was so great. And I think I love the fact that what other makes him feel like he had so much growth is that scene after Dustin leaves the car and he looks at Nancy, and you can see a look on his face. To me, that look on his face represented, it's over, I can accept it and move on. Like, he's no longer hung up on it, because he's accepting that Nancy and Jonathan are meant to be together.
Yeah.
And that he's like, you know, it kind of looked like, well, you know, it's over, but I'm not going to, you know, let it change me, kind of thing. I like that idea that he's accepting of it and he can move forward, which I hope for moving for next season. Now, I want the Dustin and Steve relationship to continue. I kind of want like a little bromance with Jonathan and Steven.
Yeah, I think
That'd be great.
I think. Well, we could talk. Do you want to go into talk about next season, or do you want to go further into?
Let's keep talking about that. But I just wanted to bring that little small part up. That's what I was hoping for. But let's talk about Eleven and Hopper.
Of course. Yeah, go ahead. I'm going to let you take point on this.
I really liked it because it kind of gave Hopper some more stuff to do. Mm-hmm. And I like the fact that because he was such a broken father in the first mm-hmm. one because he felt like he messed up his father, that just gave him a second chance mm-hmm. to kind of be a father. And even then, like, he makes his own mistakes. Like, he kind of gets manipulative with her, like, you know, when he... You know, he forgets the candy in movies, and also he's like, oh, I'm going to sit here and eat this candy and get fat.
That's just being a dad.
But I liked the relationship between them because it built even stronger because by the very end, you know, how they still, like, have that stern, like, where have you been? And then they still, like, give each other a hug, and you can tell they really care for each other. What did you think about it?
I thought it was great. I think it's fantastic because I think this whole series is working towards the story, and I think this is just part of the story. It was always going to be Hopper and Eleven having this bond, which is interesting because they had no screen time together in season one. That wasn't what it was about. It was about Hopper was kind of, he had his own
figuring out the mystery.
Figuring out the mystery and growing as a person in that regard. He never knew Eleven existed until like the very end. It was more about Eleven and Mike. And then this season, these two characters who had nothing to do with each other last season, that becomes this big thing. But I think that was always the story because he is this broken man who lost his daughter and now he has this new daughter. At the end, he's adopted her. Like, he's like their father and daughter. So it's great. I mean, it's exactly what that character needed. It's exactly what that character should have gone through. I mean, it's just like, I think that was the premise. I think that was like entirely in their minds. Like, yeah, this is going to be the story of Hopper and Eleven. We just won't get to it for a while. And I just thought that was great.
Yep.
I think that was probably maybe even the centerpiece of the season. We haven't talked about it until this point, but I think that's probably like the center point is that relationship,
mm-hmm.
And maybe even going forward will be a big one. But
and I even like the confrontation because I knew it needed to be answered when Mike finally sees Eleven and he realizes that she's been here the whole time, and he gets so pissed at Hopper.
That was fantastic,
which I can understand because I mean, Mike, you know, was kind of emo Mike because he didn't mm-hmm. have Eleven because he didn't have somebody to impress necessarily, and. That's one of the things I also kind of wanted to talk about. Which one did you? Is there a relationship specific you want to talk about?
I think I covered. I mean, okay. Yeah, Hopper and Eleven, and Mike and Eleven, and Max and.
I will bring up. I wanted to think that I didn't necessarily if I liked or not mm-hmm. was the fact that because we wanted to know like how the heck Eleven you know got back to this side. You know, I didn't like necessarily. I don't know if I like it how she basically came back to our side, pretty much the same night. You know what I mean?
Well,
like,
okay,
the season opened, like...
I think we were supposed to know that already, because at the end of the last season, he leaves the waffles in there. And I guess I thought...
But that was Christmas time. That was, like, months later. You know what I mean?
That was like, a month later. I mean, I think 2 months. But it was, like, it was honestly, like... I mean, I feel kind of dumb, because we even said in our trailer reaction, I kind of thought that he was somehow sending that stuff into the Upside Down, where she was, which doesn't make any sense. And then I thought in the trailers where she finds it, that she was in the Upside Down, like, it was some sort of, like... But it wasn't. So I think when they did that... Like, the fact that she comes back so suddenly, like, oh, she just came back through, is kind of like, what? That's stupid. But I think we were supposed to know that already. So if you watch the first season and then, she is back in our world. So you already knew that she was back in our world. It's just a question of why she hasn't come back yet. And that's the, you know.
And
so
I
that
do,
was that sat better with me after that. I was like.
I like the idea of, like, keeping her safe. But as far as, like, I just know, I don't know if I like that, you know, she basically came back that same night. Like, she destroyed the Demogorgon. She got put in the Upside Down, but she just came through that same night and just, you know, because she was going straight to Mike's. And I do like how they answered that, like, because I was like, well, shouldn't she just go straight to Mike? And she tried, mm-hmm. but she ran away. So now let's move forward to the last bit of pieces, which would be...
Real quick.
Which would be theories and predictions moving forward. What are some of the things you think will happen moving forward?
All right. Well, first of all, we know that this is, as far as the overall story, we know that this is a two-fronted story. We have mm-hmm. the story of this lab that experimented on kids, which leads into the story of this alternate dimension because one of them opened it up. So, but they're two separate things, really. So first and foremost, we're gonna probably meet members of the first eight or the first seven kids plus 9 and 10. And that may coincide, I'm sure. It'd be interesting if they just took a whole season off from the Upside Down and just made the second season, made the third season about finding all those guys or about that. I doubt they will. But honestly, I don't know how the Upside Down is going to come back into focus because it looked like they were pretty well and done. I'm wondering if the things that got sprayed in Hopper and yes. Dustin's face is going to have... They didn't tease it at all. Like, even in the, at the end of the first season, you knew that, like, Will was throwing up things. They didn't even tease that. So I wonder if it... Because when that happens, I don't know that anyone watches that and thinks, oh, yeah, that was just a thing.
I think it's going, like, to play a big factor in next season. Dustin and Hopper, yeah.
Yeah.
Because they inhaled whatever that stuff
was. But
then
Hopper was looked over by everybody and, like, you know...
Was, yeah, but so was Will, and he was like, oh, he's fine.
Yeah.
So I think
that, yeah, I think that might play a factor. As far as all the character development, I don't really, like, now that these kids kiss, are they going to be all, like, couples that have been together for a year? Like, 13-year-old couples? Like, you're going to see Lucas and Max, like, at the at the D&D table, and, like, Mike and Eleven, like, PDA, you know, like, hey, you know, like, I mean, just, like, I don't know, but, like, because they're, like, they are so young, and they're not, I mean, so I wonder how that's going to affect them a year later, because it's going to be a year later. I think
I can see, yeah, one of the things I can see moving forward is that the relationship between Mike and Elle moving much stronger, kind of not just starting to get to know each other more and try to mm-hmm. trust each other more, kind of having a strong relationship moving forward, which I can see having some great scenes, not just romantic scenes, mm-hmm. but like fun scenes, you know, like going and having fun or just talking and yeah. kind of exploring her having powers and stuff like that.
I'm wondering, Elle, for me, she is more articulate this season. She's yes. like, she was like, I'm Elle, you know, and then now she's a little bit, she's much more, and I'm looking forward to seeing, like, as the seasons go by, she's just going to become totally normal.
Yes.
Like, by season three, she can be like, come on, Dad, I'm going out with Mike, God. Like, you know, like, you don't even know. You don't even know. Like, I mean, just like, I'm wondering if she's just going to be, like, become, like, progressively more normal. I think that's really interesting.
One of the predictions I have is I actually think, I don't necessarily think it's going to be a huge back burner, mm-hmm. but I think Will is going to take a little bit of a back seat next season. Not necessarily, he's still going to be in the group. He's still going to have yeah. you know, lots of screen time, but it won't be like him in this season where he was the focal, I think one of the focal points of the story mm-hmm. and one of the key plot devices.
Yeah.
Whereas I think now, I mean, maybe Dustin and Hopper might have a little more yeah. to do with whatever stuff got ingested within them. Mm-hmm. I think... what do you think? Do you think there's any way for the Mind Flayer to even try and find his way into season three?
Well, I think it has to be because that's what kind of the story is, and that's what they definitely showed at the end of season two is that he is, even though they didn't like tease how that he is gonna. It's, I mean, that's their villain. I mean, it's gonna have to come back eventually. You mentioned the projects might come together and team up to stop him, Avengers style. But the other two characters, is there any other like character development things that you want that you think are going to come into focus in season three? Because I can think of two right off the bat.
As far as character developments, I can think I definitely think there's going to be a romantic because they teased it, and I think it's going
to
happen between Hopper and
Hopper
Joyce.
Hopper and Joyce.
I think
happen.
It's going to happen because they teased it so much because you can tell they care about each other, not just as right. friends, but as you know, as in a physical way.
It's a romantic
but she's still you know reeling from Bob, so I think it's going to take a little time, but mm. I still feel like the tension's there and it's going to happen.
It'll be a year later, and that's been one of their things, like from the beginning, you know, you watch the first episode of the show, you're like, that's the sexual tension. I think that'll be a huge focus. I think that will come into focus in season three. I think you'll see them start to have those feelings and then by the end be hooked up. I predict by end of season three there'll be a couple. Which would be interesting because if they were to like eventually get married or whatever, and then like Will and Eleven would be brought like stepbrother and sister, and that would cement the family focus more. We were also talking about, we just mentioned Jonathan and Steve. Mm-hmm. I think that at the outset of the next season, you know, Steve is with this whole one of the great things about this show is that it's about this makeshift family, which I love. Yeah. That's why I love it, because every story that I love is about makeshift families coming together through circumstances. Like,
yep.
Google my... It's not on Google. But if I were to put a list of my favorite stories, that'd be it. And this whole group is sort of... Now this group must somehow form a family. That's mm-hmm. the way they all became the Brady Bunch. And Steve is not really going to be hanging around... he might be, you know, giving rides to Dustin or whatever, but he's not going to be hanging around Nancy and Jonathan, because he's her ex-boyfriend, that's the third wheel, so there's going to be that alienation. Maybe he's accepted it, but he's not going to be like super in with everybody else. He's not going to be having Thanksgiving dinner with everybody. So I think that's going to be at the outset, and in season three, we're going to see a bromance between Jonathan and Steve. I think that'll be a focus.
That'd be great.
I think that'd be great
development as far as like, you know, them being rivals of being friends.
Right, and I think by the end of season three, they'll be like hanging out together, all three of them, and that with everybody else, and you'll see all the more firmly cemented this family, which I believe is now up to 10 members.
I don't know if it's going to happen. What I really actually want to see happen is finally a friendship of some sort and actually more interaction between Will and Eleven. Because if you think about it, they're so intertwined between one another. They're so connected, but they never really have a lot of screen time together. Like that scene where Will's passed out and Eleven goes straight to Will. Like, you can see there's a connection between them because how it seems every time one's in the upside down and one's in the real world.
Yeah,
They're never really there. And I hope they're going to maybe explore more of a friendship between Will and Eleven.
That's
because I feel like that would be really great to see on screen because they never really had that. So. Mm-hmm. I think we pretty much covered it.
Yeah.
That was really good recap.
Season 2 was good.
That was so great.
So, things looking forward to season 3. Jonathan and Steve bromance. Joyce and Hopper romance. Will and Eleven friendship maybe. And
exploring more with Lucas and Max.
It's like I said, the romance thing is kind of bothersome when they're 12. But, I mean, yeah.
Dustin and Steve.
All the relationships plus with the...
what's going to happen with the mind flare?
And finding the other experiments. And so, yeah.
We'll find out in season 3. But that'll do it for today, folks. Thank you very much for watching. I know it's going to be a long one, but we wanted it to be that way. We wanted to get into an in-depth discussion with this whole season and cover a lot of things. But what did you think of Stranger Things Season 2?
And what are your predictions for Season 3?
Yes, leave your comments section below. Give us your predictions, your likes, your dislikes, some of the Easter eggs you may have liked. Just share your thoughts down below. Let's keep the discussion going. I mean, this show is so great, and I really can't wait to see what they do moving forward. And if you haven't checked it out, watch Beyond Stranger Things as well. That was a very insightful show. I really enjoyed watching it. I watched it right after Season 2. And check it out and tell me what you think.
Oh, Jim, what's his face who did the interviews? We'll probably be in Season 3.
Yep, he will be. Also, if you like what you watch, then hit that like button and subscribe to our channel so you can see more of our various content in the future. I'm Josh Williams.
And I'm Ryan Murphy.
And thank you for keeping it real.
With ReelTime.